The call is something inside that you know you have to answer, you have to explore it. It's a call to be aware that this is something you have to do. This was something that was in me from the time I can remember back for any strong desire. I'm Sister Joanne Crefcoeur. I'm a Mary Knowles sister. I'm 85 years, and I've been here at Monrovia, California, since I returned from my mission in 2004. If God wants you for something, He'll prepare you for it. He'll give it to you. My mother said she knew it all my life. My father was a bit more hesitant, and my brother was not at all too keen about it. But I don't think anyone ever had the support that I had from my family.
I'm Sister Marian Pusht. I'm a Mary Knowles sister, now living in our retirement community of Monrovia, California. I'm 87 years of age, and I love every minute of it. I love Monrovia, and I love the people, and I love the work that I've done here. I was born in Yonkers, just north of New York City on the East Coast. And for the most part, I lived there until high school. At college, I began to go to New York City for classes.
My name is Sister Patricia Norton. I'm 84 years old now. And my final place where I was working was Korea. I grew up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. I went all through grade school and high school with the sister school. So I think you could hardly help but, you know, being a young Catholic girl and looking at the nuns for 12 years, but I really wasn't attracted to it. I want to do this kind of thing. But with me, it was just a feeling inside, God is calling, and I better do it if God is calling.
I remember in third grade wanting to be a mission sister, and I must have scribbled off, I don't know how, a letter to a community down in Ohio. And I explained who I was and how old I was, and I wanted to be a missionary sister. This was third grade.
Just a sort of a conviction, you know, and not really wanting to do it. But then I thought to myself, God is our creator, and like a man who makes a watch, he knows what a watch should do, and God created all of us, so God probably knows better. And just a conviction that I couldn't shake it.
That goes over a 20-year period. I think I was a slow learner. I didn't become a sister until I was a doctor and trained and had my degree and had graduate school and was almost ready to get married. And I thought I really should give God a gift. And I thought, well, the best thing I could do maybe is to be a nun. And my brother said, don't go there. From what I've heard about them, you'll go in as a doctor and end up a cook. You'll be in the kitchen. And you know what? He was right. I said, no, if God wants me to be in medicine, he'll take me out of the kitchen. But I went to Mary Knowles as a postulant, as a novice, as a junior novice. I was in the kitchen. So God had the last word. I was in the kitchen, but I ended up never stopping medicine. Once I got to Africa, I went on the medical track, and I never stopped.
I have always felt that Mary Knowles looks for the person who you are, what you are, even as they send you to others in need. Mary Knowles is a great blessing. I can't imagine being anything else than what I am.
We Mary Knowles sisters all over the world, we get a lot of publicity. Oh, you know, all these grand things you do. And what I like people to understand is we wouldn't be able to do anything if it weren't for the local people in every one of those countries that we worked with.
One thing was definitely what the Mary Knowles magazine put out by the Fathers, Mary Knowles Fathers. It was at that time called The Field Afar.
Many, many Mary Knowles sisters and seminarians and priests will tell you that it was that first attracted them to Mary Knowles. You know, you open it up and it's, you know, the nuns are riding horseback over, you know, to save a life, somebody in the Africa or over the Andes Mountains or something like that. And that's very attractive and exciting.
You know, it wasn't until I was in my internship residency, that part of training, when I began to go to some of the clinics for women, and I began to see the way the doctors would treat the clinic patients. And it was a combination of being angry, going to God for, how could you do this to women? They're so poor, they need medical help. I got much closer to God, I got much closer to women, and I began to circulate again in my mind and heart the idea.
I think the biggest direct power or encouragement or strength giving was a story about Father Jerry Donovan, who was a missioner over in China territory, and very long ago, we're talking about 1945 and 46 in there, and he was captured by bandits and held for ransom. And Mary Noel was in a terrible quandary. The fathers, what do they do? And the decision had to be made if they could take any Mary Noeler captive. They would be forever demanding money, and every missioner would be at a greater danger. So Jerry Donovan was found something like 6 months later, out in a desert somewhere. But that made such an impression on me, the decision that had to be made and how it was made sometimes at the sacrifice of one, which is what Jesus did for the many. I shouldn't say nun, because nuns are generally those who never leave the cloister. And Mary Noelers certainly do leave the cloister. We do go out. That's the essence almost of our activity, going to others.
I was assigned to Africa, Tanzania specifically. It was Tanganyika at that time. It became Tanzania later after independence. I was assigned to them as right after my profession, which is right after 3 years. And the bishop wanted me for a hospital, but he didn't tell me it was a combination of grass huts. They were huts that he was going to let me use for a hospital. I was there less than 3 days when we got a message that the hospital, quote unquote, which were the huts, had burnt to the ground. I think, again, the Lord took care of it, because he wasn't going to have me get started in grass huts. I wanted to do proper medicine. So I started with 4 buildings, no electricity, which didn't matter, but no water, which did matter. And that was the introduction to my next 10 years.
I went there in 1952. The people of the country itself, the original people, are called the Singhalese. And some of the other Mary Noel sisters were already there. And working in this hospital, it was a 600-bed hospital in Sri Lanka, and 1,200 patients. I was working in a children's ward the whole time that I was there, and there were children with severe malnutrition, typhoid, even diphtheria. And because it was a government hospital, the part that we worked in was for the poor, was free. And so the poor people didn't speak English at all. So we really had to know the language, and we spent one whole year studying the language. It's a very difficult language to learn, mainly because they don't have any books. Nobody else in the whole wide world wants to learn that language. The people themselves want to learn English. And it would be only, you know, missionaries like ourselves that would want to go to a country like that and want to know the language of the poor people. The people were very lovely, and the country is beautiful, and it was the history and culture and everything are very, very interesting. And our sisters were there, and we were working at something we really wanted to do, and we thought we were helping. And so I was happy while I was there.
I was in Hawaii. I remained there for 12 years. At the end of that time, while I was still there, the word came from Mary Newell, will you go to the Marshall Islands? The Marshall Islands, first of all, are made up of 29 atolls. An atoll is coral that has formed on top of under the ocean volcanoes. The people themselves, they're tanned by sun and God's own care, and knowing they'd burn to pieces if they were white, for example. Kind, looking for someone new to love. That's one way I'd like to say it. They are the kindest people I have ever met. We never went to an island unless they invited us. That was one thing we decided, that we weren't going to go in if we weren't wanted. We ended up going at least 6 or 7, which was as much in the eye of the atolls as we could possibly have touched. I think the thing about our work that just so I will never forget, and I hope I can live it to the end, God was so much with us. And those are not empty words. So many times, things that you'd just wonder, can I even do this again, when you don't get rain for 2 years? Just that somehow you always made out. And I remember times when Rose and I really didn't have much of anything left, because we had to depend on boats too. But someone would knock at the door, often a little child, and they'd hold up on a green leaf, big green, usually a breadfruit leaf, and Mama, meaning Mama sent. And there would be maybe 2 little rolls there, but they wanted to share what they had with us. And this is the kind of life that we led. It's just an unbelievable thing.
Another sister, she lives here also. She's a Korean doctor. So she called me up one day and she said, how would you like to go to China? This was 1996 that I went there. We went over to work with the other religious community of sisters who were building a hospital in China. They built the hospital, they equipped the hospital, and then when it was all built and equipped, the government said, no, we're going to run the hospital. I stayed there for a couple more years working in that hospital that the bishop wanted us to do. And then I came back here to the States. I went to graduate school. And I didn't have a choice where I went after that. When it was about time for me to graduate, I got a letter one day saying, you're going to go to South Korea. And we knew the sisters were doing, you know, terrific work there. You know, a refugee situation is just really desperate. We worked in kind of a supervisory capacity, which was also kind of not the kind of a thing you would do in this country. I was right out of college and became a supervisor.
I was in Africa almost 25 years, almost half and half between Tanganyika and Kenya. There was never any question in Tanzania about acceptance. If you could help them and they saw you did something, if you could give a baby an aspirin and the fever would drop and the baby would begin to chuckle, you were next step below God. The bonds that I formed in friendship and in love and care, they for me for them and they for me, I think those are some irretrievable gifts that I could have never, ever, ever gotten were I not a part of mission overseas. I never would have met the people I did working in this country. I never would have had the background of training. I don't mean just medicine. I had medical training, but the training that one needs in awareness, consciousness, opening one's heart. Those were gifts that I received through Marinol in large measure, but in large measure too from the people that I worked with all along.
We had a lot of teaching to do. It wasn't just ABC and 2 and 2 is 4, whole concepts that we tried so hard not to lose their beautiful trust and simplicity, but to know that you've got to keep thinking, using what God has given you when you're making decisions. And I remember at one point when we had a new school, a new place, and the children didn't know us too well then. And I was telling them about the man on the moon, and the little fellow down in front of me said, "Sister, Koreab, oh, that means you're lying." You know, and he said it so vehemently, "You're lying." I said, "No, this is a part of humans. They try to always move ahead, but not foolishly. God gave you a head, a heart, use them." I said something about, "Tamant, I feel so badly that the people are so poor and have so little." And he looks at me almost with disgust that I shouldn't know that by now. And then he said, "We're not poor. We take care of each other." Never forgotten that.
I've been retired now 10 years, and I've been here that long, and my life has been every bit as vital as it could have been were I overseas.
I had been really altogether, if you put them together, 50 years out in mission countries in the work that we Mirno sisters do. I'm still healthy enough. I could still work. I could have stayed in Korea. The Korean people are just such vigorous and hardworking people that every work that we went into, first of all, medical work, and then the Korean people caught up with all the medical work. After that, it was for factory workers because of the big industrial push in Korea at that time. The Korean government kept catching up with us, or progress in Korea, I should say, kept catching up with us.
For me, it was having lived with just Sister Rose Patrick and one or two other sisters, and to go to the center and live with 300 sisters, old or young or whatever, the new and the old, I didn't think I could face it. I felt I needed to be in a small community. So I asked for here. I knew that I was meant to go out to others and tell them about Jesus and that they were loved. That was there from the beginning, and thanks be to God, it still is.